Today we have with us the pediatric intensivist Dr. Javed Ismail with special interest in pediatric critical care nutrition, discussing on nutrition in critically ill patients.
Hello all. In this video, we shall be discussing on one of the important but often neglected aspects in intensive care, that is critical care nutrition, more specifically pediatric critical care nutrition. To support my claim that it's one of the neglected aspects, here is a survey conducted across 20 units in United States and Canada. The formal nutritional curriculum was not longer than 5 hours per year. And also, the fellows were either very uncomfortable or somewhat uncomfortable in various domains of critical care nutrition. In this video, we shall be focusing on physiology of ICU nutrition, more specifically effects of starvation, challenges in pediatric intensive care, and how to assess nutrition in children. In the subsequent video, we shall discuss on more practical aspects like timing of nutrition, enteral versus parenteral, and other know-hows. Energy intake is an intermittent process, whereas energy expenditure is a continuous process. Between these two, the nutrients are stored in the body and expended as required by the body. This is controlled by various physiological mechanisms that act simultaneously. Now let's imagine a healthy adult who is starving for a duration of around 72 hours. There occurs a breakdown of stores. Glycogen, being a ready-made source of glucose, is broken down first. This is followed by lipolysis. The starvation is prolonged for a duration more than 72 hours. The glycogen is already depleted, so lipolysis and protein catabolism takes over. We know that the protein is an inefficient storage form of energy. For generating 1 gram of nitrogen, around 36 grams of skeletal muscle has to be broken down. On an average, a starving adult can lose up to 10 to 15 grams of nitrogen, which amounts to 300 to 500 grams of lean muscle mass. During a process of starvation, the body tries to conserve energy by decreasing the energy expenditure, and the body goes into a hypometabolic state. In any stress like critical illness, there is a combined neuro, immuno, and endocrine response, which is stimulated at various time points, all of which affects the metabolic response. The initial response is a sympathetic response followed by an endocrine, and within days to weeks, it is taken over by inflammatory response. In acute phase, overall, there is a breakdown of fat, muscle, resulting in production of ketone bodies, and muscle breakdown resulting in generation of amino acids, which is shunted to generate acute phase proteins and gluconeogenesis. Comparing stress versus starvation, the energy expenditure and oxygen consumption is very high in stress compared to starvation. Also, the lean muscle mass loss occurs early and rapid in case of stress. Let's try to characterize the metabolic response to stress further. This occurs in three phases. The F phase, where there is a decrease in energy expenditure, followed by a flow phase where there is a variable increase in intensity of energy expenditure and also of variable duration depending on the etiology. As the body recovers from the critical illness, energy expenditure gradually decreases and switches over to anabolic phase. As we know, pediatric ICU is a heterogeneous population. There can be various etiologies in the same ICU. Patients with burn, trauma, there can be a significant increase in energy expenditure, which can be again of variable duration. Whereas an acute illness like sepsis, the increase in energy expenditure may be short and may be of very short duration as well. The right side graph is of a patient with major burns. You can see that the increase in energy expenditure was up to a tune of 80% above the baseline. And this increase was prolonged for a duration of up to 1 year. Various studies have tried to characterize the energy expenditure during the ICU stay in various cohorts of patients. In the first graph, we can see in a cohort of mixed diagnosis, there is a gradual increase in energy expenditure as the ICU day progresses. Whereas in congenital heart disease cohort and traumatic brain injury cohort, there was a serial decrease in energy expenditure as the ICU day progresses. There are various factors that influence the energy expenditure. These could be disease-related, or ICU interventions, or a nutritional intake, or the host factors per se. All this can influence the energy expenditure. Now let's move on to discuss a combination of stress and starvation, which is potentially harmful to a patient in ICU. In a study which compared nilparoral for 4 days versus healthy controls, even a short period of fasting for 4 days, there was a significant duodenal mucosal atrophy. Also, there was an increase in mucosal permeability. Similarly, in a study which compared early feeding, which is starting enteral nutrition within 24 hours versus delayed feeding, which means no enteral nutrition for first 4 days, delayed group had a reduction in glucose absorption when it was restarted after 4 days. Patient in the ICU can have splanchnic vasoconstriction, decreased GI motility, relative exocrine insufficiency, and malabsorption. All this can result in overgrowth of pathogenic bacteria, which is called dysbiosis. On top of it, the patient can have a loss of epithelial integrity, which all can result in transmigration of pathogenic bacteria, resulting in further worsening of immune dysregulation and culminating in multi-organ dysfunction syndrome. The other factor which can potentially affect the clinical outcome of patient is the baseline nutritional status of the child. The anthropometric parameters like body mass index and mid-upper arm circumference were directly predictive of mortality, by which I mean that those who were undernourished had poor clinical outcomes during the ICU stay. Similarly, in a retrospective analysis of a large database, suggested that there is a U-shaped relationship of baseline nutritional status and mortality. Both undernourished children and obese children had higher mortality compared to the normal nourished children. In a multinational study across 8 countries, it was observed that higher the daily caloric intake was associated with lower mortality. Increase in caloric intake from 1/3 to 2/3 of what is prescribed had up to 77% reduction in mortality. Similarly, increase in protein intake was associated with lower 60-day mortality. So how do we assess a nutrition in a child admitted to the ICU? First, as in any patient, we take a detailed history, which should include rate of weight and height gain, dietary intake in a previous day when the child was well, history of previous hospitalizations or chronic illness. Clinical examination should always include anthropometric parameters, and also we should look for any signs of micronutrient deficiencies. At the end of assessment, if the child is undernourished, we should be able to identify one of the potential mechanisms like decreased intake, increase in metabolic demand, or excessive loss, or malabsorption, or a combination of any of these. There are several factors that influence the energy expenditure in a child admitted in ICU. There are ICU interventions which actually decrease energy expenditure, like sedation temperature control, decrease in physical activity, and decrease in respiratory load because it is taken over by the ventilation. Whereas critical illness per se tends to increase the energy expenditure. So a patient in the ICU could be hypometabolic or hypermetabolic. Various factors like different etiological diagnosis, different phases of critical illness or recovery, or if they are fed or not fed, the child can be either overfed or underfed. Each of these has its own complications. Overfed children can end up in complications like hepatic fat deposition, increased carbon dioxide production, and hyperglycemia. Whereas those underfed can result in poor outcomes due to ICU-acquired malnutrition, delayed wound healing, prolonged ventilation, increased risk for healthcare-associated infections. As we know, about 70 to 80% of the total energy expenditure is contributed by the resting energy expenditure. Growth, which is halted during the critical illness, diet-induced thermogenesis is insignificant, and physical activity being halted during critical illness, the total energy expenditure is almost taken over by resting energy expenditure. The resting energy expenditure can be determined by 2 common ways. The first is to measure using indirect calorimetry. Second is by predicting using equations. Let's discuss about indirect calorimetry, which is the gold standard. The physiology behind indirect calorimetry is that it measures both oxygen consumption and carbon dioxide production in a child. As we know, the nutrient contains carbon skeleton, which combines with oxygen to produce ATP and carbon dioxide. If we measure the oxygen consumption and carbon dioxide production, we can apply it to the modified VRS equation to calculate the energy expenditure. Indirect calorimetry is accurate and gives a personalized value for that patient. And these values are independent of severity of illness or a baseline nutritional status. The limitation of indirect calorimetry is that it needs a special equipment which may not be available in many settings. and the cost involved in staffing, machine, and technical support. Also, though it is available, it cannot be used in some settings like high-frequency ventilation or a ventilator leak more than 10%. American Society of Parenteral and Enteral Nutrition recommends measured energy expenditure by indirect calorimetry to be used to guide prescription of daily energy goal. If indirect calorimetry is not feasible, then it recommends to use either Schofield or WHO predictive equations. In a worldwide survey of 156 pediatric ICUs across 52 countries, it was observed that only 14% use indirect calorimetry to estimate daily energy goals. So non-availability is a significant issue with indirect calorimetry. So if indirect calorimetry is not available in your ICU, you can go ahead with predictive equations. But predictive equations have their own problems. There are many equations. Most of these equations are anthropometry based, and these are derived from healthy children. These values may not be applicable to critically ill children, where there is a heterogeneity of age, weight, muscle mass, and the severity of illness. Time and again, studies have proven that these predictive equations either overestimate or underestimate measured energy expenditure. The other way of predicting resting energy expenditure is by simplifying the modified VIAS equation, where only volumetric carbon dioxide data is sufficient to calculate the resting energy expenditure. It has shown to be having a good diagnostic accuracy in both hypermetabolism and hypermetabolic state. Recently, artificial intelligence has been compared with the indirect calorimetry in a healthy cohort, and we can see that the blue line is the indirect calorimetry data and the orange line in the graph is the artificial intelligence data. They seem to be overlapping, but this has not come into practice in critical care settings.
If you like these videos, please like and subscribe us and follow us for more updates.